صباح الخير، أهلا وسهلا بجميع الزميلات والزملاء من مدققات ومدققي المعلومات، وأيضا الزميلات والزملاء من الصحفيين. كل عام وأنتم بخير. أعتقد أنه مؤتمر أريج أصبح الآن مناسبة سنوية ننتظرها جميعا لنلتقي ونتحاور ونتبادل الخبرات والمعارف التي نكتسبها طوال العام من العمل في المجال الصحفي. أنا سعيدة اليوم لثلاثة أسباب. السبب الأول طبعا هو وجودي في النسخة 15 من مؤتمر أريج، وأيضاً لأني موجودة في لإدارة أول جلسة حوارية نقاشية ضمن البرنامج الخاص بالشبكة العربية لمدققي المعلومات ضمن مؤتمر أريج لهذا العام. وثالثاً أنا سعيدة جداً أني موجودة مع زميلات وزملاء لديهم الكثير من الخبرة والمعرفة والتجارب ليشاركوها معنا اليوم، ونحن نتحدث عن تدقيق المعلومات في المواجهة. يبدو الحديث، بعتقد يعني أشكر الزميلات والزملاء يلي جدولوا هذه الجلسة في الصباح، لأنه لدينا الكثير من المواضيع الصعبة والشائكة التي تتعلق بعمل تدقيق المعلومات في المنطقة العربية، ولدينا خبرات متنوعة من مصر والمغرب وفلسطين لنسمع منهم وأيضا نسألهم ونتناقش معهم، ليس فقط في التحديات ولكن أيضا في الحلول الممكنة لتبسيط هذه التحديات وإن أمكن حلها. سعيدة جدا بوجود زميلاتي وزميلي بكر. معنا زميلتي دينا إبراهيم مديرة مشروع أخبار ميتر من مصر، الزميلة ياسمين اللعبي مدققة معلومات من المغرب، والزميل بكر عبد الحق مؤسس ومدير المرصد الفلسطيني لتدقيق المعلومات. أهلا وسهلا بكم جميعا، ونبدأ معك دينا، وإن أمكن أن تقدمي لنا توصيفك لواقع تدقيق المعلومات اليوم في مصر وأيضا التحديات التي تواجهها في عملك.
شكرا رشا، صباح الخير. احنا حددنا ثلاث تحديات أساسية أعتقد أنه كل المدققين في العالم العربي بيواجهوها. أول تحدي
for every team is forming a strong
من المدققين
checkers, because most of the journalists consider fact checking as not exclusive fact checking work that deserves to exert effort to, so they feel bored of that and they start returning to their daily business journalism. The second thing, there will be poor resources, available resources, so that we cannot sustain and keep the work of fact checkers working with us, because they will need to look for another job to support them at a journalist organization in order to cover their daily life expenses. The last point is the poor training in fact checkers. Fact checkers do not find time or care much for learning new tools to assist them in fact-checking. Another thing, the challenge, is consolidating cooperation between the fact-checking platforms and commitment to the principle of partnership and respecting others' rights. Many times, when the subject becomes a trend, the fact-checking platforms, they start working on that. Then after some time, we find the same fact-checking was done by different platforms without referring to the main owners of the information. At this point here, we can speak that there is no cross-border cooperation. Like if I'm working on a story in Palestine, we don't have cross-border cooperation. This is because of the competition between different platforms. The last point, which is a challenge that all of us, I'm sure, we faced, that we cannot get and or enter the IFCN, the International Fact Checking Network, because of the so many conditions that not many Arab platforms can fulfill, such as to be duly registered, which is extremely difficult because you need to pay taxes, you need to pay money, to be registered, and this is difficult. Many of the initiatives are done with individual initiatives. Also, the difficulty of access to funding, especially for platforms that cannot reveal that they are funded by X or Y organization. Also, the network has a condition that the main actors in the organization to reveal their names. And once they reveal their names, they'll be exposed to risk. These are the challenges that I'm having now. Thank you, Dina. I believe these challenges are real challenges and are not an easy to deal with. I would like to listen to Yasmin and Bakr if you have any comment on what Dina just mentioned. Yasmin. Yes, she spoke about the reality of platforms that is based on voluntary basis, and so it has difficulty to gain to be acknowledged and recognized by international platforms, and this is difficult in Morocco. Many platforms, they appear and disappear because of the challenge of the economic challenge. And I'll get into mention a number of challenges that and can undermine the sustainability of platforms, including the economic situation. That is, as Dina mentioned, most of the platforms, fact-checking platforms, are based on volunteerism. So they do not have income to ensure their sustainability. The problem, I believe, is not in having a business model. Basically, it is on how to apply this business model, because looking at the economic and media environment, it does not encourage partnership between media organizations. So among the proposed solutions is to have partnerships with media, with news websites, but these platforms usually refuse to go into these partnerships because their income basically is based on hits and titles. So they are not interested in this type of professional practice related to fact-checking. And this makes it more difficult for the platforms to sustain themselves and to further develop their work. Thank you, Yasmin. I believe this subject is extremely important and is open for discussion and with the colleagues who are with us. The idea of practicing this difficult mission voluntarily, yes, this is highly appreciated, but nonetheless, it threatens somehow, or to a great extent, personally, I believe, it threatens the opportunity or possibility of sustaining this work. Bakr, the floor is yours. Thank you, Rasha. First, I cannot start without praying for the souls of our martyrs who continue to die because of this occupation. Two of them were killed by the Israeli occupation for 2 days, Zafar and Jawad Arrimawi. First of all, I would like to thank Arij for providing this space for us as fact checkers to meet, discuss, and express, speak about the challenge that we are facing. And I would like to send regards to my colleague, Yasser Manna'a, who really wanted to be here in this forum, but he is not allowed to travel with a decision from the Israeli occupation. This is my entry point to speak about the challenge that we face in conflict area. And Palestine, being an occupied territory facing suffering occupation and division, and other Arab countries facing internal divisions and conflicts such as Syria, Lebanon, Yemen, and Libya, it makes fact-checking a highly difficult mission in terms of access to resources, And this information that is fact-checked might pose a life threat to fact-checkers, especially in armed conflict areas, because we are dealing with active electronic armies across the different social media platforms. Major part of of this conflict is based on wrong information, and also we're dealing with some people who do not accept the idea of fact-checking as related to what we do. The other issue, we have a challenge in conflict area as related to firm commitment to objectivity, and because if you side or if you are biased with any party, then this can undermine your credibility. In Palestine, we have another challenge related to the occupation media, which is a security media, and they start publishing media targeting the Palestinian media. And so fact-checking this information is difficult because we are relying on open platforms. So many times information and news items are mixed up and confusing, and makes it more difficult for us as related to fact-checking the Hebrew content. Another challenge is combating the Palestinian content. And yesterday, we spoke in details with the Facebook representatives at the training workshop and how to, to hold accountable the Palestinian content. Our page was restricted when we published material about one of the martyrs, which for Facebook is something of a violation. So we're restricted. So we cannot use terminology like martyrs or to freely research movements such as Hamas, Hezbollah, Jihad, and all these movements that Facebook considers as terrorist. So this either exposes us to restricting our content or might be even pursued. As for the other part of the challenge, it is the issue of access to information. In Palestine, we don't have access to information law. In many Arab countries, they do not have. And those who have, they are either restricted by other laws or lousy generic statements such as information that is harming or undermining national security, which restricts access to information eventually. And it's just like trying to get something out of a fish or a whale, that is when we try to get information, when we fact-checking. Although there is a law that ensures your right, but the officials do not have the culture of dealing with fact-checking platforms. Most of them, they need to make their sources anonymous, which is contradictory to the basis of fact-checking, that is, to verify the source. A piece of information that should only require a few minutes, many times it takes days to convince the officials to give the information. This applies to different areas. In Palestine, we deal with two parties, in Gaza and West Bank, making it difficult. Other conflict areas, such as in Syria, dealing with the regime compared to the opposition, so it makes it a difficult mission to do. Finally, I totally agree with what Dina mentioned. We need to get to leave the competition into complementarity and to have more respect for the efforts and patent rights and ownership of achievements. So why not to go for shared material, as happened with the Arab Network for fact-checking, and I send my regards to Ahmed Ashour, Saja, and Rawan Adaman, and all the Aregians working to ensure the success of this idea. Thank you, Wakar. Also, I would like to listen to our colleagues who are with us in the hall and our colleagues virtually with us. So our colleagues virtually, you can write your questions in the chat box and I can ask these questions to our colleagues. So I started the hall here. Can you introduce yourself? My name is Bahar Jassem from Iraq, the network for fact-checking information. A question for our colleagues. The conflict between the only source and asking and them asking to be anonymous. So it is of the public interest to be to reveal its fact. So now here we are somehow changed, different from journalism. We cannot say informed sources or something to cite that. What to do with this? Should you drop your investigation or what to do if they insist on anonymity? Thank you, Bahar. This is the first time I meet you personally, although we are in touch all the time. Okay. Thank you, Bahar. This is a highly important question. We had an experience. For a few days, we conducted an investigation related to Jabalia fire, and the source said we do not want to reveal our names.
وكان في هناك تشكيك في أنه هذا الفيديو للحريق أو ليس له، ولكن في النهاية اعتمدنا ما يتم اعتماده في الصحافة الاستقصائية، حماية المصدر، ولكن بشرط.
So we followed what is followed in investigative journalism to protect the source, but to have other sources to verify information. So we requested more proofs, and we said that we had to withhold the source to protect them. But all the information, the telephone calls, we kept them in case we were questioned, then we'll publish them. So, Bahar, yes, there is exception in conflict areas to protect the source, provided that we provide more proofs to consolidate the credibility of the sources. There is a basic information about anonymity of sources. To ask ourselves, what is the reason why the source wants to remain anonymous? To protect their lives or to publish wrong information and stay protected? Thank you. Yes, Mia? As for sources, this is a main challenge, really. Fact checkers are facing their reality. In Morocco, there are the ministries. When we communicate with the ministries, the official in charge would refuse to reveal their names. This is if they give us information at all. And if they get back to us after a week with an piece of information, they will not reveal their names, as Bakr mentioned, to keep the source as to get a complementary information to verify and approve the information that we received. So the sources is a challenge. And the bureaucracy that the information are there when we is another challenge for us. I believe the for the Akhbar meter experience or news meter, if we do not have a source and we can show, if we will not publish. We decide to stop until we get a verified information. Another question from our colleague.
Assalamu alaikum.
I'm honored to be here and participate in this annual forum. My name is Walid Ben Dahimi. I'm from Tunis. And I'm fact-checking an auditor for the companies. So I joined with Arij on petrol pollution issue. Now, as for the social community responsibility or social responsibility, we heard about the Green Middle East Conference and the international funding trends in supporting environment and also the Earth Protection Summit. And for a few years during the Obama time, he said the 21st century will be the social responsibility century. Now, what is the role of fact-checking in supporting the community or social responsibility? If you allow me to comment on Waleed's question, I believe first the fact checkers initiative to work voluntarily is it clarifies the social responsibility to a large extent, taking this risk because they are doing this difficult work in a voluntary way between the different Arab countries. So it explains their voluntary work, explains their belief, solid belief in social responsibility. I just wanted to make this comment. Dina, I believe having misleading news or false news is the responsibility of readers and audience because they spread them. When they receive them, they keep sharing them. Here comes the role of fact checkers to explain and support the principles of critical thinking and media education, saying this is a wrong piece of news. There is some responsibility. There is manipulation here. And to give the audience the same steps that we thought we used to verify this information, to verify that this is a false piece of news. So to educate the public or the audience, and so that they stop sharing wrong information and misleading others. Publishing the correction, people still tend to believe this information. The work of fact checkers is the social responsibility. This is to ensure free, proper flow of information. Another one, that is to disseminate the media education and best practices across the digital platforms to attract the attention of users to respecting the basic human rights, the first of which is the right to privacy, also to provide information about respecting issues related to death, not to publish photographs of bodies, and also social responsibility in covering suicide and other such news. So our work is basically connected and well tied to social responsibility, which really makes it even more complicated in light of what Dean and Yasmin mentioned about scarcity of resources and the also limited spaces. We would like to go to schools to have a generation that can verify and check information. I do not disagree with you. Having several platforms in the different Arab countries is a revelation for this commitment towards the community and this social responsibility. I am also observing the performance of different platforms beside the daily monitoring that hold workshops to so the fact checkers have high sense of social responsibility. A question from the hall, then a question. Okay, here. Good morning, Sahar Al-Mileji from Egypt Today or Masr Al-Yom. I'm really happy to be here. This is my first time to be here. I agree with Dina that the media vision for fact-checking profession is that it is not media, does not consider it as a media profession. So it's between a linguist and fact-checking or desk, so which makes it more difficult. But I believe the real problem here is going for a digital media, which requires a high pace and beat at work, which does not leave much space for verifying information and checking facts, checking every single word beside the picture. So my question is, my role as fact checker, does my work stop with at a certain percentage of accuracy of the fact on the news, or to provide an alternative correct version? Okay, I'll take a virtual question, then we'll open the floor to respond to them to ensure that we are on time. Our colleague Iman Al-Busayli, she's asking, why should the fact checker should be from outside the area? this is a more pressure on the journalists or the fact checkers. Would like to get your answers. How much important that the fact checker to be checking in a far away remote country. Another question from Maddah Waddah Al-Khubari. He's asking, is communicating with information providers online is considered as a reliable source of information or not? What is the second question? Communicating with fact checkers online, is it a proof that is trustworthy? I can start with the percentage. I believe you asked this question because at Akhbar Meter, away from fact-checking that is done, we do an evaluation for the professional and ethical performance of the editor as to the production of news. So evaluating the news is based on a number of questions that we answer them. If they meet, then they get a high grade. Otherwise, they would go less. So you have a criteria based on which you evaluate. Yes, these are 19 questions. So the percentage in case of Akhbar Meter, which is a unique case, I believe, in the Arab world, as basically percentage, if it is, let's say, 50%, then I would expect that this news has a problem in credibility or elsewhere. And if it is higher, then it will be more trustworthy. So much for fact-checking. Do we have international news that get 100%? Yes. Okay, but very limited. Most of these news are the stories. Have problems or issues related to red lines, such as humanitarian issues. The journalists can write with their, or get into areas that do not cause them problems, so they get 100%. Otherwise, it's less than that. Hopefully, the percentage will be more. Yes, ma'am. Do you have answers to the other questions? As for the question from online, there was a question, I believe, about fact-checking before publication. Should the auditor be from outside the country and why? I believe it's important to be outside the country because this will ensure neutrality and will ask these difficult questions in order to get an accurate copy. As for the second question, that is, online communicating online with the fact-checker, is it trustworthy? Yes, I believe, once you verify their personality. Bakr, as for the question related to Akhbar Meter's experience and our colleagues, based on uncalculated equation, we can verify the amount of commitment to credibility. But there is a problem with this. First, are we speaking about correct and wrong information, or are we also speaking about misleading context, like using correct information in a context that serves the agenda of that media organization? In the Palestinian Observatory, we were trying to follow Akhbar Meter, but we are halfway as related to accepting or the acceptance of media organization to the work of fact checkers. That's why we are working hard to get confidence, their confidence, in order to check with them before they publish. Maybe after we go away a long way in this, then we can provide an indicator of the credibility of this to the public. Bakr, if you allow me, as for this point, pre-publication fact-checking, we have a question from Mr. Abdul Rahman Ali Al-Zabib online. He's asking, which is more important, pre or post-publication? So you already answered. Yes, we are looking forward to pre-publication fact-checking. Yes, we will do post-publication, but the highest level is to have to publish a fact-checking culture, so that they follow this culture. And to have critical fact-checking. So basically it is before publication, although this will limit our work, but it is open. The other point, why the fact checker should be from outside the country, as Yasmin mentioned, the credibility and professionalism. But to speak about experience, we are six people. We represent all the tendencies in Palestine so that no one will side with any or to be biased and to ensure neutrality. So when you have resources, this will allow you. That's why it is more preferable to have fact checkers from outside the country to ensure the quality of the material. Also, and finally, digital communication. We are in digital age, and so this is done through different applications, WhatsApp and other applications. And I believe this is a good proof when we document these communications, and provided that you inform the source that you are keeping a copy of that communication. Thank you, Bakr. We'll take two questions.
Okay. صباح الخير يعطيكم العافية. اسمي محمد خبيصة صحفي من فلسطين.
Good morning. My name is Muhammad Khabisa. I'm a journalist from Palestine. I have two questions. How the platforms deal with the government, official government information sent to the media? Is it considered as facts? Like yesterday there was a news in Egypt that it is depicting a rosy image of the financial situation in Egypt, although they are having loans. And so how do you deal with this information coming from government organizations? The second question, the Semitex is getting into the speeches of officials. So are fact checkers dealing with something? Like, just to give an example, in the American elections, there was someone against George Bush, the senior. He said, I do not prove that he is like me. Or this is not a written, this is just something. It could be a body language. How can you verify such things? As for the official media and data, all of us are, all the Arab world are facing the same thing. We need to put all the official data and the information from other sources should be fact-checked. Yeah, it's not enough. We cannot suffice ourselves with this. As for the information from official sources, we follow the international approach. We do not use one source. We take the information from an official source and we look for another support source, and we check the quality of information by communicating with specialists, such as there was that discussion that the PA is paying to cover the prices, to make up the increased prices of fuel. This was a statement. So we checked the studies in this regard to prove that it's not correct. So we cannot deal or consider the official statements as
something.
As for the issue of elections, and this is an important question, we had an experience, and I believe in Lebanon they have an experience.
تجربة وأعتقد في لبنان لديهم تجربة كذلك أما فيما يتعلق بالانتخابات في مصر أيضا نتبع القواعد العالمية في موضوع الانتخابات وما نبحث في العادة هو السير الذاتية للمرشحين مدى مصداقيتها الوقت أوكي سريعا
تفضل
مدى مصداقية المرشحين أيضا الخطابات والوعود الانتخابية في هناك ست بنود واضحة في هذا السياق على الأقل أن نضمن أن تكون عملية الانتخابية عملية نزيهة ويتم عملية اختيار دون أي تأثير للحملات التي تكون مبنية على التضليل لم نصل بعد للمرحلة التي تحدث بها الزميل ونبحث أيضا في جوهر الإيماءات والإيحاءات وهي أعتقد عملية معقدة وصعبة وممكن الجمهور يتقبلهاش أصلا
So we rely on proofs and we verify things and we decide on that. Thank you. Unfortunately, the time is running out and we are still at the beginning of the day. I'm sorry for this. There are questions, but I'm sure our colleagues in the hall asking us to stay on time. We still have an opportunity after the session to keep speaking with each other today, tomorrow, and the day after tomorrow. I had a question myself for the colleagues, but and I really wanted to speak about suggestions for solutions. So, sorry. Sorry for this is just a comment. As a the official speakers, the official data are very documented. So your role here is to analyze them. Your problem is not in their correctness. There will be no information from an official actor as something wrong, because these you cannot get wrong figures. But as a journalist, as a fact checker, my role is to verify, is to reread them again. Thank you. Analyze them. Thank you, Yasmin, Dina, and Bakr, for this important session, nice session. As we said, discussion will continue for 3 days. We wish you a fruitful day. Thank you.